I've recently learned about three dice that have a special property. These are the paper, rock, scissors of the dice world. The first is a dice with two nines, two fours, and two twos. Second, a dice with two eights, two sixes, and two ones. And third, a dice with two sevens, two fives, and two threes. The sum on each of these dice are all the same, 30. So you might think it shouldn't matter which one you pick if you're gonna roll a higher number in an effort to beat one of the other die. But actually, it does. The dice with the two nines has a greater than 50% chance of beating the dice with two eights. The dice with two eights has a greater than 50% chance of beating the dice with two sevens. So what do you think will happen if we match up the dice with two nines and the dice with two sevens? Turns out the dice with two sevens has a better than 50% chance of beating the dice with two nines, which is crazy. A beats B, B beats C, but A doesn't beat C. These are called non-transitive dice. After learning this, I had to 3D print some of these dice so I could play fun tricks on my students. I let a student pick one of the dice, I'd pick another one, and we would roll them to see who would win best out of nine rolls. The trick is, no matter what die they pick, I can pick one that will beat theirs more than 50% of the time. My students thought I was magic, or just really lucky, but while I was 3D printing the dice, I realized there's another trick I could play. I could 3D print loaded dice. The first dice were basically empty shells, but if I filled up the dice part way, then I could make one side roll more often. I could make dice that looked fair, like a regular six-sided die, but were as unfair as possible. My initial thought was to fill up the dice halfway, to load it most to one side, but I wasn't sure if that was the best choice. So let's do the math, see how much I should fill a die in order to load it so one side comes up with the highest possible probability. Welcome back to Math the World. First, if you're intrigued by the non-transitivity dice and want to learn more, the Numberphile YouTube channel has a great video about them, and the link to that video is in the description. So let's load some dice. First, we need to create a model for the dice. A cube's the most logical shape, but how big? My non-transitivity dice are about 1.8 centimeters on each side. Let's call it 2 centimeters to make things easier. We also need to pick a thickness for the shell. My guess is that the thickness is about 2 millimeters, so about 10% of the side length. Now we can think about this shell having different levels of plastic filling up part of the hollow space and finding the die with the lowest center of gravity. We want the lowest center of gravity because that makes it hardest to tip over, or easiest to tip over if it's upside down. That gives us the best chance of getting a single value to come up. But how do we find the center of gravity, which is sometimes called a centroid, of an object like that? Centers of gravity always lie on lines of symmetry, assuming the object has constant density. This makes it easy to find the center of gravity of the shell. It has to be in the center of the shell, 1 centimeter in from each side. We could find the center of gravity of the filling also. It would be 1 centimeter in from the sides, and halfway up from the inside of the shell to the top of the filling. But to answer our question, we need to find the center of gravity of both of these two things together, which has some symmetry. We know the center will fall on this line, but we don't know where on the line. Let's look at some 2D figures to make sense of what's going on. If we have two shapes that are the same size, say squares with a constant thickness, the center of gravity between them will be halfway between the centers of gravity between each shape. Seems reasonable. Now what if we had two shapes that are not the same size? Suppose this square had 4 times the area of this square, but the same thickness. Well, the center of gravity will still be on this line between the centers, but where? Imagine we had a fulcrum and needed to balance these squares along the line. Where would you put the fulcrum? Not halfway. Intuition would say this larger square would fall, so we should move the fulcrum closer to the center of the larger square. But how far is the right amount? Archimedes derived the formula for things to balance. The distance away from the fulcrum times the weight had to be the same for both objects. So if the weights are 4 to 1, then the distances should be 1/4 to 1, or 1 to 4, with 5 total. So if we split the segments up into 5 equal lengths, the fulcrum should be 1 length in from the heavier side. So 4 times 1 equals 1 times 4, and now it will balance. This law of Archimedes can also be thought of as a weighted average. If we have two coordinates, say x1 and x2, and they have weights w1 and w2 respectively at those coordinates, then the center of gravity would be x1 times w1 plus x2 times w2, all divided by w1 plus w2. Or written another way, w1 divided by w1 plus w2 times x1 plus w2 divided by the quantity w1 plus w2 times x2. And we can interpret these two sections of the expression as the proportion each object is of the total weight. If they are both the same weight, both of these expressions multiplying the coordinates are 0.5. If one is 4 times the other, then one is 1/5 and the other is 4/5, or 0.2 and 0.8. Now we can see why the center of gravity of two weights of 4 and 1 is 1/5 of the way from the heavier weight along the line between the two centers. We now have a method for finding the center of gravity of our loaded die, if we have coordinates for the centers. Let's put a scale on this line, since this is the line that the center of gravity will always lie upon. We will make 0 on this line the bottom of the die, and 1 would be in the very middle, 2 would be at the top. The coordinate of the centroid of the empty shell is at 1. The coordinate of the centroid of the filling depends on the height of the filling. Let's call the height of the filling x. Then the coordinate of the centroid will be the shell thickness, 0.2 centimeters, plus half of the height of the filling. So 0.2 plus x divided by 2. The weight of each is proportional to the amount of plastic in each piece, so we can just calculate the volume of the shell and the volume of the filling and use those as weights. The shell is easy if we think of it as the volume of a large cube minus the volume of an inner, smaller cube, 2 to the third minus 1.6 to the third. The volume of the filling is a rectangular solid with a square base, so it is the area of the square base times the height, or 1.6 times 1.6 times x. Now we can put all of these into our formula. Notice if x is 0, then we just have the shell with no filling and the center of gravity will be 1, right in the middle. If we fill the entire cube, so x equals 1.6, then we also have a center of gravity at 1. So somewhere between these two extremes, we should find a minimum, which will tell us the lowest center of gravity. We can find this value looking at a graph, or if you have a calculus background, you can take the derivative, set it equal to 0, and solve. Either way, we get a value of about 6.5 millimeters of filling. This lowers the center of gravity to around 0.86, which is about 1.5 millimeters lower than the original die that was just a shell. That 1.5 millimeter doesn't seem like a lot. We could lower the center of gravity more by making the thickness of the shell smaller. Instead of 2 millimeters thick, what if it was 1 millimeter thick? We can change the thickness values and look to see how much the center of gravity changes. We can move the center of gravity almost twice as far from the center of the cube, around 2.9 millimeters now instead of 1.5 millimeters. How much difference does that make in the probability? It really doesn't seem like enough to make a huge difference, but to find out, I actually 3D printed these loaded dice and had my kids help me roll them 1,000 times. Okay, my kids quickly got bored, so I did most of the rolling, even went after to pay the kids to help. The dice with the 1 millimeter shell landed with the loaded side down 488 times out of 1,000, almost 50% of the time. That is a huge difference from a fair die, which would come up about 16.7% of the time. I can't wait to play tricks on my students with these. Do you know of any toys that would be good to play tricks on my kids or my students? If so, let me know in the comments. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.